All right, fig lovers, this is Ross, the Fig Boss. In today's video, we're talking about the best fig varieties that you can grow in a humid climate. And this is a video, by the way, or an article that I write here on my blog that we update every single year. So this is the 2023 edition. If you go here to my blog, figboss.com, I wrote a very large article, and you can go here into the search bar, type in the word best, and you'll find the article here, the best fig varieties for humid climates. And this is specifically for the northeastern and southern United States. How do you know if you're in a humid climate? Well, very simply put, if you go to Google Maps and you zoom out and the location that you're living in is green, the surrounding area is green, you're in a humid climate. If it's tan, you're living in a city or you're living in the desert. And so if you're in a desert-like climate, well, the weather and the humidity and the rainfall is typically rather dry. And so you guys are very lucky. You live in probably one of the most perfect or the perfect climate for growing figs is a dry climate. And you can ripen figs at a higher quality more consistently. But for the rest of us that want to grow high-quality figs and we're in these humid places that get 25 inches of rain annually or more, well, we really need to focus on the right varieties, because if we don't, we're really going to be kicking ourselves in the foot and we're not going to ripen high quality figs consistently. We may not even enjoy them, by the way. And that's really the key. If you want to have good figs, typically the best tasting figs are the ones that are the most ripe. And if they can hang on the tree longer, become more ripe, or can be picked earlier at a higher ripeness, well, then we're going to have the most success. We're going to enjoy our figs the most. And so that's what I've done here on this YouTube channel, on this journey of me growing figs, is talking about what are these varieties, discovering new varieties that have different genetics, different traits, different sizes, shapes, colors, and other things that we're going to talk about, like, let's say, the hang time, its ability to taste better when it's underripe. And a lot of these things are kind of prerequisites of information, of details that I've given you guys, so that when we're talking about some of the new varieties here on this list and in this article that you should grow in a humid climate, we're talking about the reasons why. We're not just saying, hey, grow this fig and don't grow this one. You know, we want to give you guys all, I want to give you guys all the detailed information. To me, I think that's the most transparent thing and the most responsible thing to do. It also, by the way, gives me even a better understanding of what it is that I'm talking about. So I'm trying to learn as much as I can about these fig varieties. And of course, if I can explain it to somebody else and really lay out my thoughts and details to somebody else, to me, that gives me at least some sort of authority that I feel comfortable with. So the first part of this article, as I said, we talk a lot about, you know, why exactly it is important to have a fig that can withstand higher humidity, what happens to a fig in the final ripening stage. We talk about, by the way, the genetics of the varieties, why that's so important. We talk about the five main categories of fig varieties. This, I think, is a really nice read because there's fig varieties suited for different places, right? Dry climates, humid climates, hot climates, cold climates, short season climates. And so if I'm choosing a variety for my location here in the Philadelphia area, I want a variety that's going to fit three different categories. It has to be a short season fig variety, a variety that's good for cold climates, and a variety that's good for humid climates. If the variety fits all three of those categories, well, then to me, I know that I'm making a good decision with the variety that I choose. And the variety that I choose, again, makes the biggest difference in that final ripening stage for just in general ripening figs, for having success getting it through the wintertime, or even just getting higher quality fruit that I'm actually even going to enjoy. So I give you guys all kinds of geographical clues, you know, using Google Maps, talking about the locations here. Essentially, if we live in the northeastern United States, the mid-Atlantic, we live in the southern United States, and then parts of the Midwest that extend westward from the mid-Atlantic areas within Nebraska, Kansas, Oklahoma, and West Texas, this video is really applicable to you guys. Also, we have people on the West Coast, in places like Washington State, Oregon, California, Idaho. If you look on Google Maps and you zoom out and you see that your location, your greater area is green, you live in a humid climate. If it's tan, you either live in a city or you live in the desert. And the people in the desert, well, you guys can grow figs at a much higher quality than I can. So, then we talk about some of the characteristics that, of course, make each fig variety special. That, of course, they're on this list not because of some fancy name, because they're rare or something, or whatever it is that people think is the case, but because we actually have legitimate characteristics that we look for. And we talk about these characteristics, one of which is called the hang time or the susceptibility window. And this is actually something that in the world of figs is something that I even is like an original idea. So what is that exactly? Well, it's the time in that final ripening stage where a fig is susceptible to rain, humidity, weather conditions, critter damage, bird damage, bug damage, you name it. There's a window in which we have problems that could occur. And so the longer the fig is on the tree, the more chance something bad can happen. So we want to have figs that actually ripen quickly. And if you time the number of days that each fig takes to ripen in that final ripening stage, you'll actually realize that there's quite a big difference. And some varieties can take very short amount of time, and some take a very long amount of time. We're talking about anywhere from 1 day on the tree or 2 days on the tree, all the way up to 15 days on the tree. So that's a pretty big difference, and it's all in the genetics of the fig. How crazy is that? Well, part of it is the genetics, but certainly if you assume an average temperature and you compare all the varieties at that temperature, there's a big difference just because of the genetics of the fig. All right, so then there's one thing that I really enjoyed this year, kind of adding a characteristic to this list that we haven't really had much of in the past, was if we can pick it underripe, we can pick it before the rain, again, pick it before something bad happens to the fig, and it still tastes good, well then, to me, that's a really good characteristic to have. And so we have a number of varieties on this list because they fit that bill. They're basically picked at 50 to 60% ripe or even higher than that, and they taste great. Obviously, if we can get them at 100% every time, that's going to be the best fig possible. And typically, those are the figs that actually ripen quickly with a short hang time. They get from 0% ripe to 100% ripe and have a short window of susceptibility to all these outside factors. But another nice characteristic, again, is this tolerance to being unripe. All right. So, and then of course I go here in the article and talk about, we've talked about other varieties on the blog here from prior years. We've talked about other videos that we've done. And some of these even go back to 2020, but I'm sure you could even find a video like this that I've done here on my YouTube channel, even prior to that. We talk about, by the way, if you're interested, some of the best tasting figs. I've talked about figs that fig varieties that are cold hardy, that are good for short seasons, fig varieties that you know, are meant for places like California, you know, et cetera, where if you guys are looking for any fig-related information on varieties, we've probably covered it. But again, this post here in this video is specifically tailored to the locations that I mentioned earlier in the video. So let's get on to the varieties here. And first and foremost, I think the standard is Celeste. And I don't really want to go over some of the varieties we've talked about in the past. There's a lot of new ones that we've added to this list. I think I will just briefly cover them. But essentially, Celeste has a lot of different types. There are synonyms. And not every Celeste is the same due to, I believe, mutation. I think every bud on a fig tree is slightly different than another. Some people believe in parthenogenesis, which we'll talk about a little bit later in this video. I think that's a really interesting topic. But just in general, these figs are definitely different in some degree. You know, if you have one Celeste planted in one location, 100 miles away, there's the same Celeste they may even change just due to adaptation or epigenetics. So there's a lot of factors that make these fig varieties different. And so one Celeste is not the same as another. And one of them that I found that I really liked was called the One. And we're skipping over Black Celeste for a minute. But the One is a fig that has a very, very short hang time. Shout out to my friend Bill in Missouri. This has a incredible ability as it is already. Celeste has this amazing ability to shed water from its skin. But because it also has a really short hang time, it's like perfectly ripe every single time. And even if you have to let them hang on the tree through a rain period of rain, it's still going to be fine. Black Celeste to me is just the craziest mutation of Celeste, where the skin is really quite dark blue. I wouldn't necessarily call it black, maybe dark purple. And the inside of the fig is also a much darker red. And the flavor is quite different because of that. A lot of people were skeptical years ago when I first started talking about this fig. I don't know why they would be skeptical, because it's pretty obvious that when the pulp color is different, the flavor is usually different. And this, to me, has the best berry flavor out of any Celeste I've tried. It's definitely the most intense, and it's the most complex. It's rather, to me, rather interesting. And the hang time on this variety is much shorter than about 10 of the other Celeste figs that I've trialed so far. I got to taste a lot of new ones this year from different places, and I have to say I was pretty shocked to learn that Celeste doesn't normally have such a short hang time. And that's what I think makes these two figs here so special. They not only taste great, but it's really because they ripen so quickly. And you can pick them perfectly almost every time. All right. So the next fig up here is Hardy Chicago. Nothing really changed here with Azores Dark. I did find that figs like Malta Black and Sicilian Dark, I'm very confident nowadays that the drier soil that they've been growing in for years out in the north side of the property, because it is so dry, it dramatically improves the flavor. This is just a fact. This is why I also envy you guys in desert-like climates. It's not just the air humidity, but the ground, soil, moisture throughout the entire fig season. Some people think it's just the end. I would be very shocked if that was the case. It is a consistently dry soil moisture that you want throughout the growing season, and you will have the best tasting figs that have flavors that you would not even believe existed. And I think this is why a lot of people in humid places just think some of the people in California are crazy for describing some of these weird flavors that we've never really picked up. We laugh about it. We make fun of some of these people. These flavors are real. And some of them are a bit crazy in their descriptions. We don't have to be a sommelier. But what I'm trying to get at is that if you have a dry soil, you will be amazed, even here in a humid place, how different. If you plant it in a dry soil, let's say you had, and this is a great example, I have a Teramo fig that I've had in pots. Really wasn't that impressed with the flavor. It's a hardy fig. It's an early variety. Planted it in the ground, out in that dry soil, and it has an amazing flavor profile that even rivals Smith and Campanieri. And I got Big Bill over here, the guy who found it. He couldn't believe how red the interior was. So for me, I know that that's a huge factor. And even it's going to affect the way I plant my fig trees permanently in the future. That's a big thing. And that's why they're off the list, because I can't add those two to the list right now. Malta Black and Sicilian Dark, because I've had them in such a dry soil for so long that my data on them is just skewed. Now, Norella I've had in a container for a while now, and it was just one of the ones I've been trialing. I've acquired maybe close to 20 of them, of 20 Hardy Chicago types, just like Celeste, as I mentioned. And I really wanted to figure out, of the best ones that existed, because there's already a lot of good data on which ones taste better than others. There's quite a few of them out there, and people really like certain varieties. And I've tried a lot of them. And so far, Norella is by far and away, I think, one that belongs in an even higher tier than the majority of the ones that people like. And the reason for that is it has a similar texture that Azores Dark has. They're both very thick and jammy. I also kind of think that Norella is definitely larger, but it even sort of resembles like an Italian 258 at times. Like it's so different at times than a Hardy Chicago that you're almost like, is it even in that category? I mean, that's how different it can be. So I would highly recommend it. I think Khan's also pretty good. Forgot about that one. But we're going to have, of course, to see more data on it. This year was not a good year for my country. All right, Campaneri, it's nothing really has changed except that in the dry plot we have in the front, they're insanely good. They rival Smith. Even if I have them in a pot or in a different tree, they're still really good. But in that drier soil, they produce some of the best figs of the entire year. And they've done that for like 2 years in a row. Best figs I've eaten 2 years in a row. Best tasting figs. And then we have Little Ruby. Again, nothing new to report about Little Ruby except that this year wasn't a very good year for it. And I am pretty upset about that. I don't like to put figs on this list and then have to take that back. If they're on the list, they should be on this list and permanently on this list. Now, maybe I guess at some point if I want to lessen the number, or maybe if I really want to whittle it down, and maybe at some point I could remove the worst ones on the list, even though, you know, I don't think Little Ruby necessarily even has a replacement just yet, because it fits a flavor profile that's unlike any of the other figs. It's just so darn figgy. It's the closest fig I've got to like eating a dried fig. So I couldn't even take it off the list if I wanted, for that reason, but it just didn't do well this year. And, I don't necessarily know why. We had a drought last year, and that was a big reason maybe why it was on the list this year. And the same thing I could say for LSU Tiger. Really impressed me last year, and I wonder if that drought really was the thing that did it last year. Now, things change with figs a lot, and some people make the argument that, oh, well, they're just different year to year. As they get older, they mature, they get better and better. 1 year, this tree doesn't do well. And even if you had, let's say, two LSU Tiger figs in your yard, maybe one does well and the other one doesn't do well. I mean, there's like so many weird things that people come up with. And I think a lot of it is just the soil moisture. That soil moisture has a huge part. And even the way you prune your fig tree has a huge part in how the figs taste next year, the size of the fruits. So I'm really curious to see what happens, but LSU Tiger is the same thing. It's a really nice fig. I'm not going to say that it doesn't belong on this list, but it definitely has a uniqueness to it that you just kind of have to try. I mean, it has this unique chewy skin. And if I was in a slightly drier place than me, this is definitely a fig that I would try to grow in a more humid place. You know, the jury's still out for me, but, I think in certain years, this is like an incredible fig. And by the way, Little Ruby was one of the few figs last year, because it has such a short hang time, that got through Hurricane Ida with no problems. It was the only fig after 5 days of rain, moisture, and no sunlight. The sun finally came out that sixth day, and I was eating Little Ruby figs at a very high quality. And all the other figs just turned to crap for like 2 weeks. It ruined out all of them, pretty much. So, yeah. I mean, like I said, I'm like low on these two, but it's hard to be low on them, you know, considering some of the other amazing characteristics about them. And just the fact that they're on this list, to me is, it's hard to be low on them. I think we just have such high standards because of the other figs on this list. And the next one here is Moro de Caneva. Again, I've told myself I wouldn't talk too much about some of the ones that have been on this list, but this is an insanely productive tree. And it also has a nice ability to like kind of keep growing and fruiting at the same time, kind of like Ron de Bordeaux does for me. So it just keeps pumping out figs, and I even got two crops of it. Through reverse pruning, I was able to get two crops of main crop this year. It's supposed to produce a good Breba. I think all of them dropped this year. Commercial variety, this would be probably the number one. It even tastes great underripe when picked early. In fact, I really like actually picking them early and then drying them on the in the fridge, just skin side down. You cut them in half, put them on a plate, and they turn out really good. Neruchilla de Elba, same story, nothing really different with this. I find, though, that the skin can be quite bitter in the fall, and I realized why this is. The sweetness of this variety is rather low, and so when you have a bitter skin, it contrasts with sweetness, just like acidity does. Acidity contrasts with sweetness, and you try to get a good balance between the three. And in figs, that bitterness comes from the skin on a lot of varieties. But because they're just so so sweet, the pulp, you don't really notice the bitterness. On Neruchilla de Elba, you do. Because I think the sweetness is probably a bit lower, or the bitterness is a bit higher in the skin. So in the summer, when the sugars are really pumping and the fruits are really ripening at a higher sugar content, you don't really notice it. But in the fall, I think it's definitely something you'll notice. And to me, it's not a big deal. I just kind of wanted to mention it. I actually like the slightly bitter note in the skin. Then there's a Verdolino, and you know, this year in Italy, I got to visit Italy on a trip that I paid for, and I got to meet the guy who named Nerino and Verdolino. Nerino is a named variety of Moro de Caneva, and it was amazing to meet like a modern day Galicio basically at Omazzoli Nursery. Shout out to Cornelia and Mattia and Francesco. They're amazing over there. So we talked with them about Verdolino. I actually got to see the mother tree, a couple mother trees they have. One of them is massive. Just absolutely massive. They're all over the lake there of Lake Garda in northern Italy. And it's just clear to me why these figs are so well adapted here. When you go there, you figure it out. There's a lot of rain towards the end of the season. And these figs here, Nerino and Verdolino, clearly in that part of the world, deal with that fall weather better than the majority of varieties in existence. So it makes sense that they would do well here. One of the things that I thought was interesting was the parthenogenesis theory that Mattia Omazzoli and also Sergio Carlini believed. Sergio actually even proposed this theory to the University of Pisa. I got to email back and forth with him a little bit on this because it's interesting. You know, there's a fig I also grow called Fico Salame. And when you when you taste Verdolino and Salame side by side, you're like, are they the same fig? I mean, they look the same. The fruits are very similar. The shape of the fruits is a little bit different. And the leaf pattern's very different. So they're definitely different varieties, but they're so similar, like the Hardy Chicago types or the Celeste types. You wonder, well, how did that happen? Like I said, I think it's mostly due to mutation. That I think these figs mutate. Now, Mattia and Sergio, they believe that there are a certain percentage of seeds that can be germinated from female figs that are unpollinated. So even though it's a very small amount of seeds, what if there's a Verdolino fig around Lake Garda that when a bird eats the seed and poops it out, even though it's unpollinated, the fig then germinates, and you have a whole new variety that is born. But because there's only one parent, that new variety will be very similar to the mother tree, but of course different. So I think it's very interesting. Is that how there's so many different hardy Chicago figs? Is that if you could germinate a portion of the seeds, plant them, you know, unpollinated, would you actually end up having a variation of hardy Chicago? To me, it's extremely interesting and worth talking about in another video. So we'll save that for another time. All right, Hativ, the Argentile. This fig just gets better and better every year. I don't really have a ton to say about it. Shout out to Dennis Johnson for really being the one to, you know, inspire me to grow this one years ago. It's beautiful. The flavor is incredible. And it even does so well, in terms of its conditions and the like rainy conditions. I picked a ton of these this year. They're good size too. Kind of similar to size to Norella almost. And you can pick them early and they're still really good. But if you can wait, they're incredible. All right, so Green Michurinska. This was a variety that Penn and Pike found in Bulgaria. Shout out to him. We did write a comprehensive variety review on the blog just on this variety. And it is, originally it was proposed by Kelby Taylor to the fig communities to be an early ripening Adriatic. And I was so skeptical of that. And I didn't, every year I tasted it, and I was like, oh, it does kind of remind me of an Adriatic. Then the next year, it didn't remind me. And then it did, and then it didn't. And then I was like, I don't get it. And so this year, finally, I got enough of them, I think, that I was pretty confident that they are an early ripening Adriatic. I mean, it tastes just like an Adriatic. I wouldn't say exactly similar, but very similar. And, you know, it ripens early, which is really what we wanted to find. Everyone in the Northeast who grows figs and lives in these shorter season climates, this is clearly a better choice. It does ripen, I think, around the same time as Hardy Chicago. I don't remember the exact date, but to me, that was that's amazing. I think it's at least 2 weeks earlier than a variety like, let's say, JH Adriatic. And to me, that's, you know, that's a big deal. All right. The other Adriatic I really like is Prosciutto. And the reason I'm high on Prosciutto last year and the year before, I really thought it has better drying capabilities and became a better tasting fig more consistently than the other Adriatics. But this year they were so big that they didn't do that. It's in a 15-gallon pot. It's an ultra-productive fig, but I think what I really like about it that I didn't know before is that it produces a Breba crop. It produced like 12 Brebas last year. And they were very good. Some of the best Breba I've ever had. So if that can be consistent, to me, this is like, all right, we'll send this one to the Pacific Northwest for you guys out there and who rely on the Brebas. This is like the best Breba, one of the best Breba varieties I've tried. Rissoulette. We've talked a lot about this variety last year. I don't really have much information on it other than, or I should say new information, other than it is becoming quite established now for me in the ground. So I'm excited about that. Next year, I think we'll definitely get a taste of it. Next up, Rosalino. Again, don't have a lot to report. That's new. To me, this is one of my favorite figs. It's a variety that is popular in Tuscany for drying purposes. And I find when they do dry, they are really, really good. Very fruity. Some of the best figs you can eat. When they're underripe, they're not so special. And to me, they kind of reminded me of a Hardy Chicago. But once you really notice the leaf pattern and you get a better detail of the figs, you realize how different this variety is. And to me, I'd rather plant this one in Tuscany than Dotato, which is all over Italy and all over Tuscany. This one, to me, is better. And so is Verdino, by the way. If you live in those places, don't plant Dotato. It's everywhere. All right. So then we've got Smith. and Texas BA 1. Again, nothing's changed. I think Smith is probably the... I almost want to say it's the best fig I've got. It's pretty darn close. What I just consistently love about it is that it tastes amazing, but the hang time's a lot shorter than I thought. And it's consistently a very short hang time. You know, there were figs that we've talked a lot about in the past in other episodes of this that we've done in prior years where things like varieties like Elba, Verdino del Nord, Celeste, Smith, they all have this incredible ability to withstand the rain. Just above and beyond so many other varieties. The problem, though, is that I'd rather just pick them before the rain. The rain can be unpredictable. And it's nice that they can withstand that if I can't get out there and harvest. And probably the average person who wants to grow a fig in a humid place, that's going to be a great choice for them. But for me, I'd rather just pick all my fruits before the rain, if possible. If it's not too intense of a rain, if it's just a light drizzle, if it's going to be a short period of time, then I'll leave them on there. If it's, you know, much more rain, and we're talking about like close to a half inch, maybe 0.4 inches, 0.3 inches of rain roughly. Yeah, even a quarter of an inch of rain sometimes will be enough to really damage the fruits on the trees. And I'd just rather not let them be on there if I can pick them early. And so to me, that's where Smith's just like, out of all the figs that have that short hang time, it just tastes so amazing. So I just, for that reason, it's got to be number one in this current knowledge of what it is that I know about figs. And we'll probably change that later on. Texas BA1, we talked about this probably a little bit last year, but this is a hardier version of Smith, but I don't know necessarily if that's true. I think it's slightly different than Smith, but I think Smith has the potential to be actually quite hardy. So I don't necessarily put too much stock in that this is just a hardier version. I think it's about the way we prune it, how we protect it. Vagamond, this is another one. Shout out to Penn and Pike. He found this one as well. It's a really, really nice fig. Very intense grape-like flavor. It's beautiful. The fruits did fantastic a couple years ago in rainy conditions. Like, the skin's perfect. It never splits. It never cracks. It's just, it's a really nice fig in rainy places. Verdino del Nord, same thing. Nothing's really changed. I did learn a bit more about this variety. First off, it must be said that it does take a while to mature. I think when this fig was really popular a few years ago when I started talking more about it, people just were not patient enough with it. You have to be patient with this. In its second, really its third year here, it finally did well. If you're going to prune the heck out of it and you're going to just not be patient, it's just not the greatest fig right away. It's kind of like a hardy Chicago. I found a lot of the hardy Chicagos really come into their own in like year three. Celeste is the same way. They just take some time, and pruning them and just not being patient is not good. Anyway, the other thing I've learned about this is that this is a fig that's kind of all over Northern Italy as well. And it even has another name, I believe, called Zigalino, which I learned from Mattia and Cornelia at Omazzoli Nursery. There's also Secolino. And there's other names that I really need to find out. I'm growing, I think, one or two of them here. That there's also, by the way, that Dan Foster, shout out to Dan Foster, has mentioned to me, called Verdal Ibiza. That was found by Figus du Monde. Figus du Monde also found Rissoulette and a couple of the other varieties. Campanieri on this list is another one. And Dan Foster believes that Verdolino is quite similar to these as well. Verdal Ibiza is similar to this Verdino del Nord fig as well. So pretty interesting. And it makes sense that this would be the Verdino of the North. I thought about this just now, actually. When I visited Ciro in Italy, he's a commercial grower in Tuscany. He mentioned to me that many years ago, every household had a Verdino tree. Verdino is just another name for Adriatic. We call it Adriatic here just because we're just weirdos like that. The Verdino del Nord means of the North. So it's the Verdino of the North. And it tastes very similar to Verdino or Adriatic because it has this awesome berry flavor to it. But it's smaller. It even produces Breba. It's much earlier and much more rain resistant and split resistant. And therefore, it's suited for the North, which I just find to be such a suitable name for this fig. All right. Now we have Noir de Boulogne and Barnes. So finally, we got a new one on this list. And these two are synonyms. I did compare them side by side here in this video. I was wondering how that was happening, and I really broke that down, actually, into a comprehensive variety review I did of this. Bode, another grower that I highly respect, he's one of the few people that puts out a lot of information about the varieties he's selling, just like myself and just like someone like Pons. They're putting out actual detailed information about their varieties and making that available to the public. This is one that he really likes and has propagated a lot of and has sold a lot of, and it makes sense that he would, because it really is, like he's mentioned, the queen of figs before the Col de Dames became popular in France. And it just, it makes sense because it's incredible. It's got the same awesome thick texture. The berry flavor isn't as, I would say, as nice as the Col de Dames. It's not as intense. It's more of a sugar fig so far. I wonder if that's going to change. I hope it's going to change. It's very productive. It's reliable. It even ripens sort of around mid-season. It, to me, is like a clear Col de Dames alternative that is a better choice for a lot of people. I've got a couple of these in pots. I think I've got like one or two in the ground, if I'm not mistaken. And I'm trying to propagate the heck out of this to get more of this in the ground and get it healthy. That's the other thing. Barnes Sote is not very healthy. Even Boulogne is not the healthiest tree. So I'd like to get them established and out to people. This is a new one as well from Michal in the Czech Republic. Shout out to him, man. I forget his website. I really would like to put his website in the description. Ah, man, if I think of it, or if Michal, you see this video, reach out to me. Because this guy, he found two really nice figs. There's Nin V and Nin ZS. They're both from Croatia and the town of Nin. Nin ZS to me this year was incredible. It gets this, the interesting thing about it, and the way you can identify it, is it gets these sugar spots, but they're not really sugar spots. There's something different. It's like a cosmetic thing on the skin that shows up that's brown and black, and they're spots, but they're not your typical sugar spots. They're just different. And I don't know if I think it's just purely cosmetic. Like a sugar spot, I think, is almost sort of a negative thing in that you'll see in humid climates, and is more, I think it's more than cosmetic. I don't know. I'll have to deep dive into that at some point. But yeah, I think it's really productive. What else did I think about it? It has a short hang time. It's a mid-season fig. It's got the right shape, a long stem, closed eye. And the fig, by the way, tastes amazing. It's really, really nice. So for me, I did a taste test of this, and to me it was one that stood out. We also had a tasting here at the house that it was a standout for a couple people. Pernet Noir is next, and this is a fig that's like Rissoulette, an alternative and an improvement to Black Mission for people in humid climates. This was originally sold by Harvey at Figaholics. It didn't really have much popularity. He dropped it from his orchard, I think. But I don't know. I just went back and looked at it and realized it has a really long neck. The stem's kind of short, but the neck is long. And these are just really nice figs. They just have this ability to ripen quickly, short hang time. They avoid a lot of moisture. They ripen rather quickly, and actually they ripen over a longer window. That's one difference with this variety. It has a long harvest window, but it is around, I think, early to mid season that it ripens. It is rain resistant. It wasn't totally impervious to rain, but I think that had something to do with my watering practices a little bit. And in general, the hang time is very short. In about 3 or 4 days, it's dry on the tree, which to me is incredible. So it tastes great every time. The one thing that I think is a negative is that it has a slightly bitter skin that some people, again, with Elba may not like. Again, it's that contrast of bitterness and sweetness. For me, it's awesome. Now, there's also Marseillaise. This is a new one, and this is one that Bode sells a lot as well. This is a fantastic fig that I would put in the same category, kind of like in size. It's also kind of dwarf. It's a small fig. It's dwarf. The figs are small. The leaves are small. There's a lot of productivity. It's a similar shaped fig as Elba and Verdino del Nord. I kind of think of this as like another fig berry. Remember that term? That shout out to you guys that know what I'm talking about. And so, yeah, Marseillaise has just never really gotten any attention because it has a similar name to White Marseille. But I promise you, this is extremely different. This is far superior in humid climates. It also tastes better, I think, even though I like White Marseille a lot as a fig. But yeah, it does have a little bit of a splitting problem that I think Bode and someone else I know has mentioned. Not that it splits a lot, but it can split. Campaneri can do the same thing. I mean, Campaneri can split, and it's really because of the shape. It's got a rounder shape. But I didn't note any of that this year. I picked every single fig off my potted fig. There was like 50 of them, and they were perfect every single time, and they taste amazing. They dry quickly. They dry easily. Really did remind me a lot of like growing Verdino del Nord. The taste is different. It's more like a sugar fig with fruitier notes. It's very fruity. One of the fruitiest figs I got, along with Rosalino and Sauche. Corio Province. This one also is quite fruity. And shout out to Justin Patton, man. This is just an incredible fig. I'm really happy that he found this and introduced it. And I, for so many years, thought it was just Sucrète, which is another fig I really like, which I was like, oh, I can't go wrong with that. It could be just Sucrète. Well, then I'll just have another Sucrète tree. This is quite different. It's definitely very different. Excuse me. Definitely very different. And this fig, I don't really have, I guess, a ton that I was able to observe. Each fig that I picked, it seemed like they were on the tree unripe. The next day they were ripe. And I'm like, wait a second. Am I just not paying attention? Or was this fig just so quickly ripened that I didn't even notice? So I think it has a very short hang time. I think that's pretty much a guaranteed thing. But every time I went to film it or take pictures of it or eat it, I just ate it really quickly and didn't think. And such a mystery, this fig, that I don't know. I kind of miss some things about it. But in general, I think it's probably mid-season, quite productive. It's definitely productive. I've seen Justin's trees, and they're very productive. Great performance in humid weather. That was something I did notice, is that the variety definitely can get through rain without any problems. You know, Verdolino this year, we had a lot of rain one period of time during the season. Verdolino was one of the few that got through that rain period as well. So, you know, shout out to Verdolino as well on that. Then there's the late ripening varieties here. I see we still have to format this a little bit. But these late ripening varieties, I was so skeptical for years to put some of them on this article because I just haven't had enough time to evaluate them. You know, I feel in a way similar about Choreo, but I know that if it has a short hang time and it tastes good, there's a very good chance it's going to make this list and stay on this list. You know, that's really the biggest thing, is that hang time. But some of the late ripening varieties, you know, you find that you can't evaluate them that well because here I don't have a long enough season. This year I had a commercial greenhouse that I had access to in the spring, and so a lot of the trees got a really early head start, and I was able to evaluate them very well. And I'll say that because it's later in the fall, the hang times increase. The soil temperatures go down, the metabolisms go down, and the figs take longer to ripen. They have longer hang times. And so as a result, you know, they're typically not great performers here in a humid climate because they just don't, they can't get perfectly ripe or, you know, become somewhat of an acceptable fig before the rain comes in the fall and ruins them. But I have found about five or six varieties that I would consider in the fall to be really great options for people in humid climates. So, you know, I would separate these in just a totally different category. Some people can't even ripen them in the length of their season. I have all these trees, by the way, planted in the ground. I'm hoping to ripen all of them in the length of my season. I think I will. So I'm in the Philadelphia area. I think if you go further north, I probably would stick to them in containers, try to get them an early head start. You know, all that heat and microclimate stuff goes a long way. But, you know, I would try to go for some of these varieties because they do ripen late. And I just find that these are really nice figs late in the season. So that's kind of what I'm getting at, is that I really do appreciate them for that purpose. So first up is De La Roca. I've been singing the praises of this fig for years. I remember years ago, it was like the best fig I ate at the time off my own trees. For a long time, it was like the best eating experience I've ever had off my own trees. And it's pretty darn close. It still might be up there. Maybe Paradiso Bode is up there too. And Paradiso Ciro. There's quite a few. Coldenon Blanc. So yeah, I just think that this fig is just amazing. And yeah, it finally proved itself, by the way, to have somewhat of a short hang time. I remember years ago when I was growing it, I was not really paying attention and really evaluating or even aware of what the hang time was at the time. I mean, I didn't even really have that idea to pay attention to it. And so I never really knew. I thought it was short, but it's got the perfect shape. They look just kind of like a Coldenon without the thick neck. It's a more elongated shape. The figs are fantastic. They're well adapted to humid weather. I mean, that's the whole thing with this fig, is that in Ponza's book, where this fig comes from, Montserrat Ponza's collection in Spain, he mentions that it's growing in a garden where it was found, and there's frequent irrigation in the garden. So he thinks that it could have adapted well to humid conditions because of that. I just think that's so interesting. Coldenons are next, and that was originally why I tried to find, you know, why I'm so interested in De La Roca, is because it kind of is like an alternative to the Coldenons. There's not many figs that I've find have that awesome thick pasty texture. I saw a video recently. Somebody was saying that the Coldenons, when grown in the Pacific Northwest, don't really have much of a difference in texture compared to a lot of other figs. And I think that's rather interesting. You know, I appreciated their point of view, but I have a hard time believing that. There is a significant difference. And I've had some really nice figs grown in all different types of climates. You know, I've grown figs and even here in like perfect weather compared to the figs in poor weather. And you can just get a pretty big difference in these Coldenons if you, you really can enjoy them probably at the right time. I mean, I think part of that guy's problem was that they just ripen so late for him, and it's tough to get them ripe in the Pacific Northwest. So that to me, you know, good on him for obviously being aware of that and sharing that information. But, you know, I just got to push back on that. It's just, to me, these are seriously amazing figs in terms of texture. Now, if I'm in the Pacific Northwest, maybe I don't grow a Col de Dame. Instead, I grow De La Roca, or I grow Marnisot or Noir de Boulogne. But in general, I found that some of the problems with these Col de Dames is that they're just a bit finicky. A lot of them are really infected with, the fig mosaic virus, and severely infected. And because of that, you can't get the performance and the ease of growing them that you want, and you can't get them as early as you want. If you can get them healthy and grow them in a pot, especially Col de Dame Blanc, I find is a really nice one. It's super productive. You're going to get them earlier than if it's really infected and just a poorly grown and terrible variety, you know. And that was the problem for years with a lot of these trees, and still is with a lot of the sources of this fig that you can find. Until you plant them in the ground, rejuvenation prune them, and get them really healthy, which is what I've done now with my Col de Dame Mutante and Col de Dame Noir. What I really should do is take cuttings and air layers from both of those trees, put them in pots, and then evaluate them again. I'm anxious to see just how they do in the ground, so I'm not too concerned, I guess. But I would really like to get a healthy, really, really healthy tree of both of those, grow them in a pot, and see. Same thing with Col de Dame Gigantina, all the Col de Dames. And here's all the different types. You know, there's Blanc Noir and Roja and Greece. They're all relatively the same. They have different growing characteristics, but they all relatively taste the same and give you that awesome texture that you're looking for. Gigantina is just a bigger Blanc. Col de Dame Catat is misleading and not a Col de Dame. It's actually a Hivernenka fig that we're going to talk about in a minute. Bordeaux Sotenka actually seems very different as well, and I'd be very curious to see what this one does. I have never actually grown it. The Col de Dame Blanc and Negra is a bit of a mystery. There's also Sarda, which has an interesting, really interesting story from my tree this year that I will get into probably at some other time. Then there's Col de Frar, which I think is worth growing, and I'm trying to see if I can get cuttings from this one, because this one actually could be a really nice alternative as well. But it turns out that I found at least three of the Col de Dames I would find are rather healthy, worth growing, a little bit less finicky for people in northern places. Now, if you can grow them in the ground, like let's say you're in West Texas or somewhere in the south, like, man, go for it. You know, you got the length of the season, you got more sunlight there, more heat, I should say, and you're able to really get these figs going. But for me, I got to be a little bit choosy, and I want to grow just the best sources of these figs possible. And one of which is Col de Dame Mutante. It's just so darn beautiful. It's also very healthy now for me. It seems rather productive. But even more productive is this Col de Dame Blanc. I cannot believe how productive this is. Then there's Col de Dame Cartagena, which Bass introduced. Shout out to Bass. This is a really nice, healthy source that is very similar to Col de Dame Noir. And this one to me, I really like. So I'm planting this one in the ground and also trying to propagate a lot of it. There's a Hivernenka is the next one. And this is probably the latest fig on the list of all the late figs I have here. There are some, I think, that will ripen a lot earlier than others, but in general, these are going to be even later than the Col de Dames. And so you might want to be careful about that. But for those of us in the South and in, you know, those places I just mentioned that can really plant a Col de Dame in the ground, you definitely want to plant one of these too. Even people in dry places should be planting these. You know, it's just, they're such amazing figs. Here I've got a couple of them in the ground. I got quite a few in containers. I think I can even ripen these in the ground. And What I find is that there's a lot of them. There's a lot of misinformation about them. People are not educated on them. They're right up there, and they should be considered in like the same way that people think about Black Madeira and Golden Elm. They should also think about the hybrid Inca figs. Some of them are, you know, very different than others, I find. There's quite a big variation in these, and I'm hoping one will ripen early. I'm hoping one will have a very short hang time, like De La Senora Hivernanca had. There's also DN Amoros, which looks certainly like a Hivernanca, but that one in Ponza's book has a much earlier date of ripening, so that's interesting. And then, of course, you got over here the last two figs on the list. Is Mala Vermella, Juali Noir, and Beet Ramon. I think there's more than just these three, but these are all synonyms for the most part. They could be slightly different than each other. I think maybe even it might be Roja. But I would be interested to go through Ponza's book once again and see if there's any more synonyms of this fig. I think it's pretty easy to identify now that I know what I'm looking at. And yeah, it's got a really, really nice texture. You think that the Coldenhams have a nice texture and Barnasote does. This one's different, and I would say equally as good. So another difference in texture, really well worth growing at least one of these. They also taste really good underripe, and they have that awesome texture even when underripe. The same thing with Hivernanca. They taste good underripe, and if you can get them perfect, they're mind-blowingly good. So yeah, a bit late, but some of them have that shorter hang time, like I mentioned. And yeah, they made the list because of their quick ripening period, which is their quick hang time. Even in fall weather, they taste good. And you know, you can ripen the entire crop given a long enough growing season. And it, to me, it's like a nice alternative almost to Black Madeira or the Coldenhams. Yeah, so in terms of Mala Vermella, like I was saying, it's just got that awesome quality like Hivernanca and even the Adriatics of tasting great even when underripe. So in the fall, if I'm trying to ripen a good fig, it's either got to ripen quick or I got to pick it early and it still has to taste good. You know, Hardy Chicago just takes a dump at that late part of the season. You know, Italian 258 still actually tastes great late in the season. For me, actually, I'm a big fan of Dotato late in the season when it's underripe. I actually think Dotato is quite underrated for that reason. I almost put it on this list of a source that I have that I find to be very, very good. There's also Martinenka Blanca, which also comes from Ponza's collection. Shout out to Ponza, I guess. Not that he needs the shout out, but Mala Vermella is the same thing from Ponza's collection. And Ponza was also really the one that shed a lot of light on these Hivernanca figs. I'm trying to relay some of the information, and I'm growing close to 12, maybe even 15 of these different Hivernanca figs to compare and see which ones are better and talk more about them, educate people on these, that classification of fig. Martinenka Blanca is in its own thing. I know it has the name Martinenka. I don't think it's at all similar to Martinenka Ramada. It wasn't similar, from what I remember, to Martinenka. I don't know. I could be wrong on that. But to me, it's more of a sugar fig. It's got a beautiful pulp. Very productive. I mean, it's insanely productive. The harvest window is very long, so that's a bit of a concern for such a late fig. But you can pick them early, and you're going to enjoy a lot of them. Almost all of them I picked without any problems before the rain. In super, super cold conditions, they don't really ripen very quickly. The hang time is actually long. But if you can get them, pick them early, they're still good and still enjoyable. So, you know, that's the one little caveat, I think, with this variety. The hang time is long. Actually, I find that the hang time on Mala Vermella and Beet Ramon and Juali Noir is also slightly long, but you can taste them and they still taste good when picked underripe. Now, if I plant this Martinenka Blanca in the ground, and a lot of these late figs in the ground, I'm more in favor of them if they can ripen in the length of my season than growing them in pots. And the reason for that is because it just gets too cold in the soil temperatures in pots, and they just stop. They just slow down almost like a month sometimes, 3 weeks to 2 weeks before the in-ground figs do. So I'm pumping out tons of figs in the in-ground trees well after the container figs are. And that's when it's important actually to have the late figs anyway, is in that later part of the season. So you almost have to put them in the ground. Now, of course, I would grow them in containers if that was my only option. But yeah, it's just something to be aware of. Maybe if it was super late and I could only grow them in containers, I guess the Mala Vermella, Joali Noir, Beet Ramon would be good because they're still ripening at a higher quality. And the Hibernica figs are still ripening at a higher quality in that cold weather. So in a pot, they're still going to perform well. The cold anoms don't perform as well in the colder weather. And I think De La Roca does as well. And then the last fig on this list is Colonel Lippmann's Black Cross. Boy, oh boy, have I waited a long time for this thing. It is not very productive, and I think it's just a bit finicky because of difference in sunlight hours. But the main thing is that if you prune this tree too much, you remove a lot of those apical and lateral buds, you're not going to get the fruit set that you want. So you really got to be careful about pruning this and shaping it. You don't want to do heading cuts. You want to do thinning cuts. It's very similar to Smith in this way. And you can struggle getting a lot of production. And that's one thing that people don't like about this compared to Black Madeira. Black Madeira and Italian 258, they just pump out figs, pump out figs. You know, Noir de Barbantane is, and Bordeaux Saute Noir, they're nice commercial versions of Black Madeira and Colonel Lippmann's Black Cross. But they also kind of struggle with production. It's really about that pruning. Having a healthy tree, getting a nice structure to your tree. Colonel Lippmann's is no different. It'll be productive. It'll ripen actually mid-season for you. It is very rain-resistant compared to Black Madeira. It doesn't split. It's a smaller size. The flavor's amazing. For me, I'm like, I thought that this was going to be the case. Shout out to Phil Strudel Dog down in Georgia. He is the man for talking about this, promoting it. It's pretty much everything he said. Yeah. So I know this was a long one here, guys. I was trying to keep it under 2 hours. We did that. I think the first time I filmed it was 2 hours, but there was no audio. So we did it again. All right. Well, thank you, guys. I hope you enjoyed this. If you made it this far, shout out to you. Thank you. Hit the subscribe button if you haven't. Hit the like button if you haven't. Check out my blog, figboss.com. Catch you guys for the next video. Take care.